Thank you, everybody. If you just give me one second, I'm the awkward person that has their presentation on their own laptop. You know that whole thing about if you're the smartest person in a room, you're in the wrong room? Right? There's no danger of that today, is there? I actually thought this was like 10 people in a workshop when I said yes, and I come here and like, oh, you're amazing people, talking about incredible stuff. Survival of the fittest, survival of the fastest. Oh my gosh, where do we start? You know, there's not enough people that kind of stand up in front of a crowd like this and say, our jobs are really, really hard. Do you know what I mean? It's harder than ever to measure stuff. I want to try and get into a whole load of stuff. I'm not going to do any product demo whatsoever. I'm not going to show product slides, do case studies. I'm not going to do a live demo. If you want to do that, we could do that later on. I thought what'd be interesting, because you've seen a lot of technical stuff today as well, and you're going to see some more this afternoon. I wanted to try and step back and look at the bigger picture. This is actually my first presentation for IBM, so I'm not terrified at all. Could be my last, my P45 presentation. Who knows? Because you know what? I'm a big believer that the world is probably going to change more over the next 2 years than it has over the last 20, and I'm going to try and make a case for that over the next 30 minutes. You know, when we look at people say about, you know, 90% of the world's data was created in the last 12 months, 80% of all the data in the world is unstructured, all that kind of stuff. It's kind of easy to get caught up in all of those numbers. You know, the half-life of a tweet is now 6 seconds, and people are thinking real-time is, you know, we respond within an hour or a day, and, you know, obviously that's gone and it's dropped off. We're trying to put economic values on relationships. Back years ago, when me and Dave were talking at conferences, we used to do a thing about what's the ROI of your dog? Like, you can't put a value on a relationship, so you shouldn't try. So marketing's all about reach and impressions and advocacy and all the kind of bullshit stuff that doesn't mean anything. We can get into that later on. And also, this is my sympathy slide since I've not slept last night because I've come from hospital, which is where I'm working, these little animals that are very, very premature. So yeah, how'd you put a value on that relationship? Do you know what I mean? Petra and Matilda, £2.04 and £3.07. That's done now, isn't it? So I could say anything and you're like, oh, it's all right, he's the guy with the kids. I never wanted to be a marketer. I didn't. I wanted to be Gordon Gekko. I actually wanted the red braces. I had a VIC-20 back in the 80s. I used to program it and used to try and make it look like the database from Wall Street. Remember the movie from the 80s? I wanted to be that guy. And I really liked the idea of just going and making a ton of money. And I thought, you know, all the get-rich-quick stuff. I used to read Zig Ziglar. You know, you can have everything you want in life if you just help enough other people get what they want. Got all the Tony Robbins tapes. Went to investment, City University to do stockbroking. I even went, this is my corner shop. I'll come back to that in a second. This is my corner shop, went from 12 to 14, about 14 and a half. Every single day I went and bought the Financial Times. I had no idea what it said and what it meant. I just thought through some kind of osmosis, something was going to happen as I read the stock pages and I'm going to try and figure out, you know, what this thing is. And bless him, we'll come back to corner shops afterwards. But that idea, he knew what I was doing and he thought it was a bit flaky, but he kind of laughed. But knew my family, knew my dog, knew my holidays. Always got my order ready for me, my favorite drink and sweets with the FT. And we just had a conversation, and it kind of happened quite a lot. And one of the things that I'll never forget as I was going through that kind of learning stage was something I got from Tom Peters. He ended up writing what I think is one of the best marketing books of all time. He's about $50,000 an hour. He's a pretty killer guy. He's worth his weight in gold. He's worth checking out if you don't know who he is. I got the chance to ask him once, what's the best piece of advice you could give me? Whether marketing, business, entrepreneurship. And by the way, I'm happy if you have all these slides. You can email me later, I'll show you, and I can share them all. He said, work harder than everybody else. You've got to hustle, obviously. You should go into every single meeting more prepared than anybody else, and you should always have a clever piece of research up your sleeve, no matter how junior you are. It's amazing that once you know a couple of pieces of research inside out and where they came from, the methodology, you're able to fight your way into certain cases and make business cases for why it is you do. And there's a lot of stats that you've seen today. I'm going to throw some more at you over the next sort of 25 minutes or so. But it's worth looking at stats with context. You know that the new Fiverr's come out with Winston Churchill on it and the blood, sweat and tears thing? You've seen that? What they should have done, the quote they should have put on the back is the only statistics you can trust are the ones you falsified yourself. That was really my favorite Churchill quote. So everything I'm going to say, just kind of bear it in mind. Take it with a pinch of salt. If you've got the right technology, the right tools, you've got, you know, smart enough insights about your customers, you're going to find out the stats that are relevant for you. Don't listen to what we say and just think, oh, those guys said 77%, so therefore I'm not going to, you know. You've got to look at it. And you've got to go deep. and can't just take it for granted just because we're up here having the privilege of talking to you guys. We're talking about speed, survival of the fittest, survival of the fastest. I was asking one of my friends, what does that mean? And I don't think it's been better summed up than by this image. This is the trading floor at UBS. You know, I wanted to be a stockbroker. This is where I wanted to work. We chased Manhattan back in the day. This is 3,000 workstations trying to trade as fast as possible. One of my next door neighbors works there. I asked him the other day, what makes it so great? He said, if we trade 3,000th of a second faster than our competitors, we make an extra $20 billion each year. Like, wow, I mean, high frequency trading, right? You know, the algorithms that do the buy, sell, if you've seen Flash Boys, this is where it came from. Actually, exactly the same speed as Twitter, by the way, between 8 and 10,000 trades or tweets a second. How do you make sense of all of that noise quickly and not wait within days, weeks, hours? And he also said another interesting thing. He said 20 years ago, not long after the internet was invented, average time that people held shares in a company was 4 years. Do you know what it is today? You want to guess? 22 seconds. 22 seconds. And if you think that a share is an interest in a company, we could argue that people aren't interested in companies very much anymore, couldn't we? And I think there's a big case for that, and we're going to look at that with some stuff in a little bit. But I was drawn, Wall Street was one of my favorite films, one of my second favorite films, with The Pursuit of Happiness. And I'll tell you why. Scott Brinker, you know the guy that did the big MarTech graphic, that of course we have to look at later on. He has this thing about 2016 is the year of the marketing technologist. And by that he means this is T-shaped people. All as we go out doing our jobs, used to be T-shaped people. You was good at kind of lots of things, but you had to go deep on one. But in 2016, he's saying the reason for marketing technologist and the people that are going to survive and also take businesses forward through their transformation, they've got to be pie-shaped people. You've got to go deep in two areas. And whether that's this intersection of humanity and technology, which is why I believe that marketing is the best place in the world to work at the moment. Certainly never been a more exciting time to do our jobs. But I think it's summed up quite nicely in this little clip. Just if you could turn the sound up and just watch this for a second.
Man, I got two questions for you. What do you do, and how do you do it?
I'm a stockbroker.
Stockbroker?
Oh,
yeah. Had to go to college to be a stockbroker, huh?
You don't have to. Had to be good with numbers and good with people. That's it.
Hey, you take care. Hey, I'm gonna let you hang on to my car for the weekend, but I need it back for Monday.
Feed the meter.
That was the car I wanted as well. But it's a really nice clip, isn't it? Isn't that a beautiful clip about marketing? You've got to be good with numbers and good with people. And if we think about where marketing's come from, we used to have the PR guys and brand, and we had agencies and stuff. Then we had our business insights, our analysts, our intelligence. And often they didn't come together. Back when I started out in marketing, often these people were never sharing insights backwards and forwards, which is why the metrics were so screwed up. Also why we're still struggling to measure TV, radio, billboard, press, why Nielsen's still struggling, all that kind of stuff. Because it's about how do we tell stories. But in 2016, the issue is we're trying to tell stories in swipes, right? Because the average attention span of someone's now between 5 and 8 seconds. We've got to remember that our audience, as you've heard all morning, our audience is the most important part of those stories. So we've got to figure out ways to tell those stories as fast and as compellingly as possible. We've got to break down our message, no matter how big it is, into short bite-sized chunks and one sentences. And we can look at that later on. There's another agency that I love, Interbrand. Anyone, you all know Interbrand? Awesome people. Their new report's about to come out in a couple of weeks' time. They measure basically the emotional value of a company. What goes on in your head when you think about Apple, Google, which will be Alphabet this year, Facebook, Amazon, and they look at all of this stuff and they try and put a value on it, and the people debate kind of what the values are and kind of where it sits. There's a deeper thing behind this. First of all, there's some research that we should pay attention to. Whether we believe it or not, it's kind of by the by, but the fact that there was a big piece of research done, it was about 100,000 consumers by Harvard Business Review. 77% of consumers don't want a relationship with a brand. Now, we've heard some different views of that this morning. What they do want most of the time is for you to answer your phone, reply to your emails quickly, be responsive, and be there when you need them. But our idea sometimes of a relationship is not often what consumers want, but yet we think we've got to do our branded content and we've got to get the engagement and click-throughs, and we kill ourselves when our Facebook things drop through the floor and Do you know what I mean? There's a lot of smiles. I know you. Look at what's happening. We're living in this world of disruption. I took all the data and I went back 15 years, and this could paint 1,000 different stories, but we won't dwell on it today. You think in 1997, Apple's 3 months away from bankruptcy. You've got the dot-com boom, 85% of stock prices wiped off all the Fortune companies. We've got the social web, Facebook launches 2004. We've got all sorts of different wars between companies. I work for IBM. We're going through a huge transformation of our own. As you know, we have a lot of legacy systems, everything shifting towards cloud. You had Google and Microsoft, who never used to compete with each other ever, because you had an operating system and a search engine, now compete with each other on everything. Steve Jobs came in with his big vision. I'm more proud of the things we didn't do than I am of what we did. He had such relentless focus, that's what they put down their growth to. And you could argue that they're struggling a little bit now, and this chart will look different in a couple of months' time. But this is, how do we live in this world of traditional brands for the clients we're trying to represent, and how do we tell our stories as fast as possible when everybody's terrified? I think 7 out of 10 boardrooms I set foot in last year, at some, it was worded differently, but essentially people said the same thing. We don't want to be Ubered, right? We've heard that a lot. I know it's a little bit of a cliche. 4 out of 5 executives are overwhelmed and underprepared for the challenges their business is going to face over the next 5 years. And they're making emotional decisions. We go out with our data-driven, here's our model for why you should buy our stuff, and my technology platform's awesome, and this is the case with the uplift figures. You know, fantastic. We can justify that stuff all day long. And often there's technology now that we can put values on relationships, but we can see 75% of executives still make emotional decisions concerning the major strategic direction of their companies. And often we go out with analytics and we don't go out enough with the storytelling. The reason I've got to drop this, has this been shown yet today? No? No one's seen it? You all know it though, right? And I have to do it just because it's the biggest marketing cliche for every presentation that you see. 3,876 vendors, all saying the same thing. You know, it used to be 1876 last year when it was invented, in 2011 when Scott Brinker did it, there was about 100, 150. The problem you've got, and this is, there's a lot of people tell this in a different way, but I'll tell you why I think this is important. First of all, it's gonna start dropping next year because of consolidation. All the big companies are buying all the smaller ones. But what's happening is people have this idea of marginal gains, right? These incremental returns. If we go and cherry pick all of our favorite solutions, because each team is responsible for one small slice, and we piece them together, this phrase called dark martech, which is gonna start being a thing over the next 18 months, it's not quite reached Europe yet. It's already seen an impact in the US, that people are trying to build their own marketing clouds and realize the customer data doesn't work. It's unstructured, it doesn't join up. They've got no idea. 88% of enterprise companies apparently don't even share their own data between their own sales and marketing teams. And we're going out trying to build our clouds, and we're trying to sometimes do it on a budget, and it's incredibly difficult. And the thing is, there's a huge problem. This is, we're down here, IBM, Oracle, HubSpot, Salesforce, IBM, Adobe. I used to be at Adobe, was head of strategy. I was at Salesforce just before IBM. When you try and build a single view of a customer, which is ultimately what most CMOs want anyway, especially the CFOs, because they can start putting a value on it online and offline, this, and it doesn't matter that you can't see it, this is what you've got to build. It's a minefield, and it's a flipping nightmare. You know, I work for an $82 billion company, and we've got technologies that claim can do this across different channels, and we've still got small businesses going out and trying to figure out what it is that they should do. This is why agencies like Jellyfish are so important. And I'll tell you why. This is a slide that gets me sacked. Can you all see it? I work for IBM, right? Oh, we can't show that because IBM's not top right. We only show the slides when we've kind of massaged our way into some sort of leadership quadrant, however it is that we do that. Do we believe it? Whatever. Adobe, Oracle, Salesforce, you know, IBM's a strong performer. Do you know what? This doesn't matter. And I'll tell you why, because every single one of those clouds is completely different. But if you go on their website, they'll all say exactly the same thing. Mobile, social, data science, customer journeys, marketing automation, social at scale. Everyone's saying the same thing, but actually when you look at each one of those clouds, and I know because I've worked for three of them, they all do a completely different thing for a different client base in a different industry. And it takes an agency to try and figure out what it is that you should do in order to tell your story. And too many people are either going to build their own cloud, or they're looking at stuff like this and say, well, obviously we need to go and buy Adobe. And they're not actually going back and looking at the insights in their own companies. And when you download the slides and you can see them later on, this research will make sense. But this is why it's so important, because all companies aren't created equal. When you think about strategies, you've got an element that you can predict what's going to happen in the market. God, this does sound like a workshop now, doesn't it? And then you've got an element of how much can we change the industry that we're in. 80% of businesses apparently have a classical strategy, which is kind of your annual quarterly reviews. You know, we all get together, figure out what the strategy is. But you've also got adaptive strategies if your industry is unpredictable and you can't change it, or if your industry is predictable and you can change it, or if you're in some kind of disruptive territory, you've got Uber and Apple and a bunch of other companies. You've got companies up here using strategies down there, and they're not using the resources, the agencies and the technology partners and platforms in the right way. And it's a huge, huge problem. This is a great piece of research that there's a link to that you can see. And the reason that it's changing so fast, and this might be provocative because I know we've got some people in the room that do a lot of social listening and stuff. My world used to be social command centers, when we used to listen to social media and our Instagram feeds and our Twitters and our comments from the 500,000 different social networks, the 500,000,000 blogs and forums. And we used to try and put it on a wall. But you're all familiar with dark social? Who's familiar with dark social? I'm not going to ask you what it... Okay, let me explain it really quick. Like five people put their hand up. Dark social is everything that's private. So all the stuff that's in the public domain that we can see through normal social listening tools, you know, that's all the stuff that we used to look at. But now, 75% of conversations, especially on things that people are emotional about, so Facebook talk about music, TV, fashion, film, sport, anything that someone's emotional about, all those conversations are now on private messaging apps, like Snapchat and WhatsApp and Sina Weibo and Facebook Messenger. It's worth having a look at all the announcements for Facebook Messenger for brands this week, especially with the ads that they get people within one click. You can get a customer to go and have a personal one-to-one chat within a messaging app. It's never happened before. That's going to be revolutionary in the way that you build out relationships. But the traditional social command centers don't work anymore because, on average, they claim in B2C, about 8% of the conversation is Twitter and about 15% is Facebook, and the rest of it's all private. So we can't see it. So how on earth are we supposed to build a relationship with a customer when it's all private and brands have got no place to go there? We've got to find different ways to engage. You know, we used to figure out how was it we responded quickly, then how do we do real time, and then we kind of lived in this place of how do we predict what's going to happen next. The bit that marketers seem to be missing is the prescriptive element for me about, it's all very well and good knowing the predictive analytics of, you know, this is what we but what are you going to do with that data for that customer? You know, right message to the right person at the right time. How do you do that when you don't know their information? This is a pretty badass slide, isn't it? It's a pretty heavy one. Again, if you don't know it, this is the best piece of research that comes out once a year. If this is the only thing you read, you've got to check it out. The Gartner Digital Marketing Hype Cycle comes out next month. This is the law of diffusion of innovation, for those of you that know kind of the way that innovative technologies work. Basically, everybody gets excited about the stuff at the beginning. This is the stuff you hear about at conferences and in Fast Company and Wired. Then we all realize it doesn't work and we've put our money into it and it falls off a cliff. And then this is where we start making our money. So this is generally where the marketing clouds live, because this is the productive stuff. This is email, mobile, social, lead management, mobile ads, personalization. There's one really interesting takeaway from this. And the report, by the way, shows every single one what it means and what its impact is going to be over the next few years. See what's down here? The thing that's kind of not cool anymore because we don't talk about it, and it was like, well, that was 5 years ago. The most important marketing technology that's going to mature over the next 10 years is still real time. Second most important is a phrase that you might not be familiar with called personification, which is a great word, a little bit cheesy. If personalization is how do we know all of these things about our customers to figure out what we do with them next, and we get the email, mobile, social, you know, I mean, getting the data is not the problem now, is it? I've got an app on my phone, I can point it at you guys, it tells me who you are and it'll tell me the last thing that you tweeted. And for me, if you tweeted more than 500 times, you can figure age, sex, salary, we can look at job titles, look at what you earn, your favorite celebrities, your favorite magazines, restaurants, clothes. It's not hard getting the data and the demographics. But personalization is how do we get all of that specific personal information? E-marketer research came out last week, said 55% of the UK audience, UK, doesn't want to give any data to marketers whatsoever. Not even the login with a Facebook or the Twitter. 55% of UK consumers, and it was a very, very wide demographic as well. So personification is how do you give the right message to the right person at the right time when you don't have their information, which is altogether a little bit trickier. So one of the reasons why, you know, I've scooted off to IBM, and we can get into the technicalities of this later on, but we have a cognitive element. You've probably all heard of Watson. Watson's a machine learning element that drives behind what it is that we do as a company. And it doesn't just take all those interactions from however many social networks, blogs, forums, emails, connected products. It learns, but it learns based upon emotions and behaviors. It doesn't learn based upon transactions and clicks, which is altogether completely different. Very few people know that IBM's, and this is a little bit indulgent, actually, I should just skim over this. So 105-year-old startup, it's why I joined the company. We invented the algorithms behind Facebook, all the machine learning algorithms for YouTube to be able to figure out exactly where all these billions of different screens across the world, what's being watched on them at the same time, how do you take that intelligence and how do you do something useful with it? How do you predict on Facebook what's a trend and what's a fad? The algorithms behind Uber that do demand positioning, there's a lot of patents. We do about 7,000 patents a year, I think, for the last 24 years or something. We've done more innovations than any other company in the world. Let me just show you a couple of things which I think are really interesting. And this is a little bit fun. This is a close to a demo I'm going to show you. It's just some things we're playing with at the moment with our marketing cloud and Watson. Just gives you a little idea about some kind of mechanic you might want to do with a customer that you could play with yourself. Imagine that you've got an app. You could speak to it. You could text it, like Facebook's Siri. How can I help you today? I'm going to my best friend's birthday party on an afternoon. I've got nothing to wear. I can help with that. Where is this party taking place? This is Watson having a conversation with your phone. She's organizing a party at a house in Liverpool and looking for the perfect summer skirt. Awesome. Would you like me to have a look at your Instagram profile to figure out what your style is? Of course I would. That sounds like fun. So the Alchemy API from Watson, you authorize it, and this is all about a value exchange. It can have a look at your Instagram profile, and it's looking at images, not hashtags, to figure out exactly what your style is. It can then start recommending the different clothes that you like, and using a Tinder-style UI, you can start swiping. Now, do I like this? Yes. No, and it's going to be learning over time. Do I like that? That could be going into a profile, could be going into a shopping cart, into a basket, all kinds of other interesting stuff. And we own the Weather Channel. What we could also do is predictive weather analytics. Well, it's going to be a bit cold on a Saturday night. Do you want a jacket to go with that? No, we don't. Do you want to check out? It's interesting, isn't it? Uber does exactly the same thing. Uber's able to predict to within 15 minutes ahead of time exactly where the cars are going to go. There's an algorithm behind it that figures out how to calculate surge pricing so that when you push a button, you get a car within 5 minutes. But a lot of it's done through weather tracking. How do we figure out what the weather's going to do? Because we know that's going to drive demand. How can we do predictive analytics on the sports events in each city to figure out what mood people are going to be in when they leave the game and what type of ride are they going to want home? Is it UberX, Uber Lux? You know, is it going to be an exec? Uber's interesting because it never spent any money on marketing. For every 7 rides, through word of mouth, got 1 new user. Fastest growing tech company in the world, about $62.5 billion at the moment. Most heavily backed VC company in the world. They know the emotional components about what drives people, and it can predict things like your salary, even though they don't know your implicit information. And they know, for example, for every $1,000 that you earn more in salary, and it can assume your salary, it's within about $10,000. For every $1,000 you earn more, your expected response time drops by 3 seconds. So if 2 people order a car at the same time, one's earning $10,000 more than the other, one person's going to get the car 30 seconds earlier. And it's like, at what point does someone cancel the ride? And at what point do they turn off? You could have all sorts of fun with it with your friends. And there's a whole bunch of things that they're testing. I've seen this hooked up to emails. And it can predict with your calendar about where you're going to be. You're going to be 5 minutes late going your normal route. We could get you an Uber. It'll be here in 3 minutes. It's going to cost you £8. If you just want to push this button, we can send it over. We know it's raining and you just got some new shoes. Do you know what I mean? It's like, if the value exchange is so high, people don't mind giving some of their data. They have a great philosophy with their engineering team. Normally, engineers have to write hundreds or thousands of lines of code. Uber engineers, using any number of tools, write a solution to the above problem in under 30 lines of code. What every developer has to do. This is how you talk about survival of the fastest. How do you build the fastest tech company in the world? So I'm going to end on a couple of slides, and I'm going to show you a video. And I apologize if I'm running over by 2 minutes. Is this interesting? A little tiny bit? when you look at their marketing team, and they have a math department, they don't have marketers in their marketing team. It's a really unusual company. They've got stockbrokers, right? They've got neuroscientists. They've got rocket scientists. They've got trading managers from Goldman Sachs and hedge fund managers. Why would you have that in a company that's trying to do sales and marketing and technology? Well, because they understand supply and demand, and they need to be able to do it very quickly. But they also have this saying that they rely too heavily on technology. And I love this, because I work for technology companies, but there's definitely a sense that we ask too much of technology and not enough of ourselves. The people problems, tech's not going to take over. Watson's not going to replace everybody's jobs. You're going to have some of these technologies that come in and complement your teams and make them bigger. So I asked the chief data scientist at Uber, I'm writing a book on Uber at the moment, by the way, Ubernomics. And I asked him, why have you got neuroscientists doing your marketing? He says, because we need to understand how to find a meaningful signal in a very, very noisy environment, just like the brain. So if we can turn the sound up. What I'm going to play you, just to try and prove a point, because people think technology has to solve a whole bunch of stuff, I'm going to play you a clip, and I've taken out all the meaningful information. And see if you can, you probably won't hear anything because it's massively heavily distorted, but just see if you can make out any of the words.
She writes to her brother every day.
Every day? Usually about, there was some of the words?
Brother?
Yeah, but normally about 50% of people get every day, and then there's like 10% of the outliers that get the other bits, the smart people. Listen to exactly the same clip again with all the meaningful information put back in.
She writes to her brother every day.
Now listen to the first clip that we played exactly the same way.
She writes to her brother every day.
Isn't that weird? And they talk about how do you get neuroscience and people that can understand, you know, the way that networks work. The brain and the cities are exactly the same. The algorithms that drive Uber, and some of it's powered by IBM technology, tries to figure out exactly at what time of day is which algorithm for which part of the city relevant, based upon things like weather, based upon the emotional intent of the people and where it is that they're going. And Bradley has this beautiful saying, I really like it. He says, I don't need to know everything about everyone, I just need to know a little bit about a whole bunch of people. And sometimes we're going out trying to find thousands and thousands of things and capture data from everywhere. And often we don't need to, we just don't have the right technologies in place. We need to figure out that value exchange. We share a love, me and Bradley, actually, we had a chat about Model T's, we were talking about survival of the fittest and fastest and evolution. You remember that famous quote? Of course you do. If I'd asked people what they wanted, right? You know Thomas Ford never said that. I don't know if you know that. Thomas Ford never said that. What he actually said was, if there's any one secret to success, it lies in the ability to get the other person's point of view, see things from that person's angle as well as your own. And that's really the root of today, isn't it? That's why we're here. That's all the stuff that we're trying to learn. So I said I was going to leave you with an interesting story. Has anyone seen Jibo before?
Yeah.
You've all seen Jibo. Who's seen Jibo? And if everyone's seen it, I won't show it. Can I play it? Okay.
This is your house. This is your car. This is your toothbrush. These are your things. But these are the things that matter. And somewhere in between is this guy. Introducing Jibo, the world's first family robot. Say hi, Jibo.
Hi, Jibo.
Jibo helps everyone out throughout their day. He's the world's best cameraman. By intelligently tracking the action around him, he can independently take video and photos so that you can put down your camera and be a part of the scene.
Jibo, take the picture.
He's a hands-free helper. You can talk to him, and he'll talk to you back, so you don't have to skip a beat.
Excuse me, Anne?
Yes, Jibo.
Melissa just sent a reminder that she's picking you up in half an hour to go grocery shopping.
Thanks, Jibo.
He's an entertainer and educator. Through interactive applications, Jibo can teach.
Let me in or else I'll...
Huh.
And I'll...
Huh.
And I'll blow your house in.
Hey, where'd you go? There you are.
He's the closest thing to a real-life teleportation device. He can turn and look at whoever you want with a simple tap of your finger.
Check out my turkey dinner, Mom.
I wish you wouldn't eat that.
Hey, they make turkey pizza?
I want turkey pizza.
And he's a platform. so his skills keep expanding. He'll be able to connect to your home.
Welcome home, Eric.
Hey, buddy. Can you order some takeout for me?
Sure thing. Chinese, as usual?
You know me so well.
And even be a great wingman.
You have a voice message from Ashley. Want to hear it?
Absolutely.
Hey, call me when you're home.
Better make that takeout for two, Jibo.
We've dreamt of it for years, and now he's finally here. And he's not just an aluminum shell, nor is he just a three-axis motor system. He's not even just a connected device. He's one of the family. Jibo, this little bot of mine.
Isn't that cute? It's about $4.99. It's $5.99 with an SDK kit. Going to be out in the UK by the end of the year. IBM developers are helping build it at the moment. It's actually backed by the professor of social robotics at MIT and the VP of engineering at Netflix. So let me end on this, because we've talked about a lot of innovative stuff and it's all moving incredibly fast. And sometimes it's really hard to be overwhelmed because you look at all these technologies and you don't know what to buy, you don't know what to measure, you don't know who to believe and who to trust. You're scared about being Ubered, trying to understand your customers and their behavior. Forrester has got a very optimistic view, which I completely subscribe to, and I think it's something that we should spend more time looking at. We spend all of our time trying to capture data and we don't spend enough time trying to create value for the customers that we've got. It's why the partnerships like this today are so important. Because our customers are sat on obscene amounts of capital assets, market footprint, and huge amounts of customer data that more often than not, they're not doing anything with. And it's been the case since I started in marketing over 20 years ago, that it's 7 times cheaper to keep a customer than get a new one. But yet we all seem obsessed with acquiring new customers and trying to generate leads and automate the crap out of everything. So hopefully that helps. I don't think technology is everything. I really like that quote from Steve Jobs. Technology is nothing. What's important is that we have faith in people, that they're good and they're smart, and if we give them the right tools, they're going to do something wonderful with them. Amen? Thank you.